learn tonight from ourselves. Our biggest enemy is us. Everything that we deal with, it starts with us. And so what Paul writes in the summary is that his first reaction to what he's dealing with and his first response to the challenge that he's facing in verse number 22 says, for we know that, I'm reading wrong 22, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man. And that's important for us to hear what Paul is saying, because in this setting, the word delight in the Greek is sunedomahi. Sunedomahi means to rejoice with oneself, to feel satisfied. So Paul is saying, I'm satisfied. I've been complaining. I've been talking about my struggle. I've been talking about how the enemy is coming after me. I've been talking about how I've been wrestling with this and wrestling with that. And then he turns out of this verse 22 and says, I'm satisfied. I feel good about what I know. Does that make sense? It's not so much of what I've learned to do, because that's a part of the process, but through my experience, I've come to the conclusion that this is one thing I do know, that it's a blessing to be in the will of God. And until the people of God understand that and get to that point, it's going to always be hit and miss. Paul is not dedicated because of who he is. Paul is dedicated because he respects God, trusts God, and believes in God for who he is. Does that make sense? When we get to a level of relationship where we trust God to the point where we dedicate our whole life to him, that we turn it all over to him, then that's when we'll begin to see and feel what Paul is talking about in this chapter. There was one segment of Paul's letter to the church at Philippi we talked about a few weeks ago, when Paul says, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. And part of the struggle for people of God is forgetting what's behind.
Yeah, yeah.
Dealing with, we deal with so much that oftentimes the enemy basically just comes in and takes over our thoughts, and he puts our thoughts in rewind mode, and we spend more time thinking about what we've done,
yeah,
rather than what God is doing. So therefore, what happens is the enemy creates a distraction for us,
right,
so that we can't focus on our progress. And more importantly, when I don't focus on my progress, I begin to pull back.
Yeah.
But when I'm confident that God is moving me to a different, right, level, or God is taking me to the next dimension, then my progress is based, and my energy to move forward is based on my confidence in who God is.
Yeah.
I will never be confident in myself without God. Do you understand that?
Right.
Nobody will ever be satisfied with who they are without God.
Right.
Because in my flesh, that means that I can't find anything good. And right, that's what Paul said. Let me find a verse here. In verse number 18, I think it is, in chapter number 7. Yes it is. Verse number 18, chapter 7, Paul says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I can't find it. And so what Paul is saying is that the depth and the deepness of my wrong is not based on what happens on the outside of me. It's based on what goes on the inside of me. And the struggle that I have, the issues that I deal with, are not based on anybody else. They're based on me. Why? Because either I am full of the Spirit, or I've allowed my flesh to control my actions and my attitude. And a lot of times we don't even realize what's going on. It's just, it's because it's happening by second nature. I can cuss somebody out and not even think about it, because
right,
that's a part of who my flesh is. But if I concentrate and I focus, then I realize that what I just said or done is not pleasing to God.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, what does that do? That triggers my request to God for forgiveness.
Right.
Because in doing that, now I repent for my godly sorrow. People say, well, that's an easy way out. That's not an easy way out. That's what God has given us as a part of the process to keep us in his will. If that was the case, we would never be able to please God. If we didn't have the ability to say, Lord, forgive me, or Lord, I'm sorry, we wouldn't ever do right, because we can do wrong every day.
Right.
That's what Paul says. He says in the same chapter, chapter number 7, verse 21, I find in the law that when I would do good, evil is always present. That means that I don't care what I do, I don't care how marvelous I think I am, how devoted I think I am, how majestic God is, I don't care about none of that stuff. Every time I try to do the right thing, something always comes up. But what we're learning tonight is it doesn't come up outside of who I am. It comes up on the inside.
Right.
That's where it starts. Everything starts on the inside. So what does Paul say? I delight in the law of God after the inward man. And the word delight, you hear what it says, is to rejoice with oneself. But the other part is law, the nomos, the regulation, the standard, the principles of God. So let's put it in perspective. I delight, I'm confident, I'm satisfied in the principles of God, which are after the inward man, which means that for me, I understand that if I'm really going to make it, I got to be satisfied with who I am in God.
Yeah. Amen.
And that's hard for church people. Y'all understand that, right? Because when we leave here after being here on Sundays, we go back to our world. Mm-hmm. But not realizing that going back to your world, you're still filled with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You're still under God's grace. You're still a benefactor of God's mercy. You're still covered. Amen. When you leave this surrounding, what agitates me more than anything in life is that people have the wrong perception of what the church is, which has been my drive for this whole idea of becoming a purpose-driven church and living a purpose-driven life. Because for my whole life, until the Lord gave me the revelation, we always thought that this was a church. So people ran to the building and got into the building and didn't find any satisfaction. Why? Because there were people in the building. And as long as you're around people, that people will bring the worst out of you and they'll bring the best out of you. People can make you turn, do a 180. Mm-hmm. And the right person with the wrong attitude will cause you to reverse and regress in a matter of moments. So, but it's not them, it's the influence that the enemy has given them. But here's the click. If they have that kind of influence, that means that you're not sure who you are, because you should be able to discern how to avoid those people.
Amen.
The word of God declares, resist the very appearance of evil. Y'all know what that is?
Mm-hmm.
People know what evil looks like. You know when you're walking up on a situation that ain't right. Something in your spirit says something ain't right about this. Amen. I've been in many situations where the spirit says, don't go down there. Mm-hmm. Don't do that. Don't mm-hmm. talk about it. But I need to help. You don't need to help right now. Yeah. You need to wait until after. Because if you go now, not only are you going to be vulnerable, but you're going to become a victim. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
And so when I disobey what the word of God is saying or what the spirit of God is doing, then I become that victim. Now I want God to find out. I want God to tell me why he allowed this to happen. No, he didn't allow this to happen. He tried to forewarn me that this is not what you need to be doing. This is not where you need to go. And the Holy Spirit is always working. The Holy Spirit is a part of our everyday life.
Amen.
The challenge that we face, and what Paul is saying here is, there's a space in my life. And that space is complete. Now, I have to determine how much of the Holy Spirit I'm going to allow to control that space or occupy that space, and how much of the flesh I'm going to allow to control that space and occupy that space. So when I gave my life to the Lord, I said, Lord, come into my heart. And what people don't realize is my heart is bigger than this little pumpity thing right here. It's a space that's much bigger than that. When I give God access to my heart, I give God access to my soul. So God controls my soul. He becomes the soul winner. Amen. Mm-hmm. Who I am. And so when he becomes my soul winner, that means that he now is guiding my steps. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So Psalms 37 says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. That's what the psalm says. The psalmist writes. And when David writes that, he understands that if I'm moving forward, that means that God is leading me. But where God is not leading me is backwards. And God will never lead me backwards. So that means if I'm going backwards, then I've left the will of God.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit will tell me I'm going in the wrong direction. But what I'll find is there's something in my past or behind me that I long for. And the longing for it comes from here.
Mm-hmm.
James says that when we are drawn away, by lust and enticed, which means that it becomes a part of our appetite. I don't know how you all do, but all it takes is a minute for me to desire something. So if I want wings, I'm going where they're selling wings. Amen.
Amen.
I don't go where they make it look like they're selling wings. I'm going where they're selling the wings.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not going to go to McDonald's and get hot wings. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to go to the hot wings place.
Amen.
To get hot wings. But that's what my palate or my taste and desires are. And what we don't realize is if we're not careful, we're driven by our desires.
Yeah.
Whatever we want, that flesh starts to rise up, and you get in the car and you drive. You try to find it. And wherever it tells you to turn, that's where you turn. And I learned a valuable lesson. And when they close, you just go find somewhere else.
Uh-huh.
I ain't worried about the clothes. Somebody Somebody said in some ways, I ain't gonna just let the clothes sign stop me because I'm being driven by my own lust.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit has to come in and say, you don't need it. So now I got to turn off the road, get back on the highway, go home. And if I'm satisfied with the Holy Spirit, then the taste and the desire goes away.
Yeah.
But if I don't allow myself to be influenced by the Holy Spirit when I get home, I still feel unsatisfied.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm going looking for it. Now I'm looking for a substitute. And until my flesh is what? Satisfied. So the Holy Spirit is trying to do its part. But as long as I'm willing to fight the Holy Spirit or allow the flesh to fight the Holy Spirit, then I'm going to have the war. So when I get to verse number 23, and Paul says, but I see another law. Now that's something that you have to remember now. That the word law here is nomos. Remember we said that. And nomos means regulation or a principle or a standard. So Paul uses the word but. And if you use the word but, that means it's contrary to what I just said.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of times we're operating in opposition. If God gives us a positive, and then we experience a negative, something somewhere turned the table.
Yeah.
So Paul says, I delight in the law of God. That what he said? And living by the principles of God from the inside out. But then he says, but I see another law in my members. And boy, when I start to understand this, boy, it really just opened my eyes. My members, and in this text, it is important for the church to understand that the members are not the people sitting in the pews. The members that this text is talking about are the parts of the body.
Mm-hmm.
So the parts of the body are what the enemy uses against us. And the word members here is melos. A limb or a part of the human body. Melos. So Paul is saying here, I see another law, another set of principles, another set of regulations, another standard working in my melos, my body, my members. And watch what he says. At warring against the law, the principles of my mind. So my mind here is my intellect, my thought process, how I process things. So Paul is saying here that the principles of God I delight in, I rejoice in, I'm satisfied with. But every now and then, I step away and I start to see how the enemy is working through me to get to me by opening the way for my flesh to start to take control of my steps.
Mm-hmm.
He calls that a law as well, the standard or the principles. But he calls this the law of my members, which means that our body is a weapon against us every now and then. So again, back to my example about chicken. Eating chicken is a physical desire. And then there has to be a spiritual desire. So every time I try to satisfy the flesh, it can't be nothing good. Because what Paul says in verse number 18, what? In me dwelleth no good thing. So anytime my body desires something that's not good for me, the enemy is trying to use it to take me out. And the enemy already knows what my weakness is.
Amen.
My weakness is fried chicken. So the enemy is not going to ask me to go to Subway. Amen. The enemy is not going to try to send me to Chipotle. The enemy is going to send me to B-dubs, or it's going to send me to Wings and Things, or going to send me to Hooks. Don't send me somewhere where they're not satisfying my flesh.
All right.
Now see, if my flesh knows that wings are my weakness, then whatever your weakness is, your flesh knows what it is.
Right.
Amen.
So the enemy or the flesh is not going to try to register something that don't have no effect on you.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense?
That's right.
I don't have to have a hamburger. I ain't got to have it. No, I'm all good. If we ain't gonna eat, I'm good. I ain't got to have that. But baby, let Chick-fil-A be open. Woo! Good times. I'll go 3 miles off the road, amen, for Chick-fil-A. I won't go half a mile for Taco Bell. But Chick-fil-A, if it says 3 miles off the road in the hole underneath the rock, I'm on my way. That's my thing. My wife looked at my bank statement the other day, and she just started laughing, because out of the 10 items on there, 9 of my food items. Amen. And 6 of them got to be Chick-fil-A. So I'm a Chick-fil-A heart. In fact, I got my Chick-fil-A card in my pocket. So when they give me a free sandwich, amen, I'm going to cash in myself. Because why? Because that's my sin. Amen. And when they open, I get mad. And you know I love the Lord. You know I love going to church. But there's something wrong with Chick-fil-A not being open on Sunday. After I've been with the Lord all day long, somebody ought to be able to open the Chick-fil-A and help the pastor out. But thank be to God, they ain't open on Sunday. But I know my sin. You've got to know what your sin is. And because Paul does not specifically us a very broad perspective about how the flesh works. The flesh wants what it wants. And if the Spirit of God is not rising up in you to defend you or to defend your struggle, then Paul says you're subject to the flesh. He calls it the law of sin, the principles of sin. And the principles of sin are whatever God has identified as sin. And there are no big sins, little sins. There are no white lies, yellow lies, black lies. Sin is sin. The small sins, the big sins are all the same in God's eyesight. So I can't say, well, you know, Lord, you know, I did this, but shoot, wannabe did this, so now you ought to take your attention off of me and put it on her, because her sin was bigger than my sin. There's no big and little sin. Right. Sin is sin. And in fact, Paul says in Romans 3:23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So that means that everybody is under the same banner when it comes to sin. What separates us is how much of God have I allowed to control my life. So when I tell you life, living a life, living for God is a state of mind, you need to understand that it starts with how I perceive who God is and then allow myself to grow from that. If I'm not growing, that means I'm not. How do I grow, Pastor? I grow by studying. I grow by spending time with God. I grow by meditation. That's how I grow in my confidence and my faith and trust in God. If I'm not praying, if I'm not studying, if I'm not meditating, if I'm not spending time in worship, if I'm not growing, that means that who's got the most control over my life? That means my flesh does. So when I need somebody to help me to settle down, if I've not spent that time with God, then I can't hear His voice. I don't feel His Spirit. If I don't feel His Spirit and I don't hear His voice, by nature, I automatically go where? To whatever the flesh wants. And the flesh will make you get up at 1 o'clock in the morning and go looking for what it wants. Amen.
Right. Amen.
And amazingly, the Spirit of God will wake you up at 2 o'clock and you won't know why the heck you woke up. Mm-hmm. But when the flesh wakes you up at 2 o'clock, you have no delays. You go right to it. But when the Spirit of God wakes you up, the Spirit of the Lord wants you to pray. The Spirit of the Lord wants you to meditate, because there's something coming down the pipeline that you may not be able to resist. So you need that extra time with Him so that you can overcome whatever's coming down the pipeline. And even if you don't know it, trust God enough to know that if I'm spending this time with Him, there's something special that He's trying to do to keep me covered.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I want to stay covered, because if I don't stay covered, automatically I'm going to always lean toward the flesh. That's what Paul is talking about. So he calls it a war. Now we all know what a war is. A war is just a conflict. But in this particular case, the word warring, according to the Greek, means, and it's a long one, it's antistratyoomahi. Antistratyoomahi, which means to attack and destroy. So Paul is saying here in verse 22, for I delight in the Lord after the law of God, after the inward man. But I see another principle, a set of regulations in my body, warring, attacking, and trying to destroy the principles and the way I think in my mind. And because of that, it's bringing me into captivity, to the law of sin. So when I yield to the flesh, it automatically encaptures me or enslaves me to sin. It automatically puts me in a place in my life where I do more through the flesh than I do in the spirit. When I allow myself to be captured by my sins, it puts me in bondage, as we learned earlier today. And there are so many people living in bondage. They look good on the outside. They're faithful in their attendance to coming to worship, but when they get here, because of the bondage, they can't experience the presence of God.
Amen.
They don't realize that the presence of God, and the Bible says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And so the more I push toward understanding who Christ is and what God is all about, God begins to break up that stuff. And then the Bible says, Paul says in chapter number 7, he frees my mind. And when he frees my mind, it opens up some space for me to ultimately take in what is being shared with me or imparted into my spirit, which gives me the strength and the confidence I need to make it through the rest of the day. But if the enemy has me in bondage and I'm sitting in here and I'm shut down, then whatever is going out, I'm not receiving it, which means that now the flesh is controlling my thinking. And so what am I going to do? I'm going to get tired. I'm going to go home. When I go home, I'm still subject to the spirit. I mean the flesh. And when I go home and I'm subject to the flesh, now me and Bebop fight. Because I'm subject to the flesh. or I did something along the way that I knew was out of character or out of context or out of my mind, and I allowed my flesh to take control and take me away from the principles, precepts, and standards of God. So that's why Isaiah says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will do what? Lift up a standard against him. Now, he doesn't say do a shout or do a praise dance. He lifts a standard. Where does the standard live? In my mind. So when the enemy comes in, the Lord has to change my mind or how I think in order for me to overcome whatever the temptation is. That's why James says, submit thyself unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee. When the devil can't control my mind, he has no access. He has no power. He has no authority. He has no room, because I've submitted myself to who? To God. So the idea that I've submitted myself to God means that I've given God full access to my heart. And that's a process. It don't happen overnight. But what Paul is teaching us is we all have struggles. We all go through something. At different stages in our lives, we're all going to experience an attack from the enemy. But the attack does not start from the outside. There's no gun shooting at me. There's nobody charging at me. The attack comes from the inside. And it starts with my flesh, my desires, my sin, and my actions, and my attitude. Mm-hmm. So God works for me to change all of those things. But he starts by changing my attitude and my actions toward him. And when those things change, then everything else around it begins to change.
Amen.
And that's how significant what Paul is saying in this summary is. He's telling us, here is how you get it done. Now, if as the people of God, if we're reading this and we're meditating on this, then we know that there's a war going on. So when I wake up in the morning, I realize that the enemy in me is fighting for control of my day. It behooves me to wake up in the morning and just say, Lord, I am so grateful to you for giving me another day. Yeah, I'm thankful to you for setting the record straight and giving me power over the enemy. Why? Because the enemy would love to see me destroyed or dead. And you've given me another day, another set of mercy and grace to get it right. So if I start my day that way, now I'm yielding to the Spirit of God. So whatever's going to happen that day, it's not going to be without a fight, but God is leading the way. God is ordering my steps. God is laying it out before me. The Word of God says that the Word of God is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway. So the minute I begin to meditate on the Word of God, then God begins to open the way for me. God begins to reveal instructions. God begins to lay out a plan for my life. And then he gives me the wherewithal or the desire to want to know what the details of the plan are, and gives me the energy to be able to live that plan out. The only way there's a disruption is the enemy in me decides he wants to do something else.
Amen.
And a lot of times we're all distracted. Every one of us gets distracted. We get a sidebar, there's something that comes up that the enemy plants as a stumbling block. If we don't know how to deal with that, then we're going to be distracted by that stumbling block. But the Lord has already taught us that we don't have to worry about that. As long as we have faith the size of a grain of mustard seed, we can say to the mountain, be thou removed. Mm-hmm. So I should not be struggling with what's in front of me. If I got faith, God will take care of that. But I got to trust God will make a way out of nowhere. That's what I got to trust. So a lot of times it's just applying principle. Applying what God has already taught me in his word. Let's move on. We're almost done. And it says, so here's the last part. The law of captivity, brings me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Your greatest challenge are your eyes, your ears, your mouth, your hands, your feet. There's a principle that God presents for each one of those things. There's one principle that the Lord presents that people think that it's literally, but it's metaphorically. He says, the eyes offend me, pluck them out. Mm-hmm. You have to deal with the source of your sin. Amen. And the minute you see it, you want it. Which is why the enemy takes that sight. And you'll find out that how sin gets in is through your eyes.
Amen.
You need to understand that. That was the first sin of Eve. The Bible says, and when she saw that it was good for food, she desired it. If she had kept her eyes closed, amen, and her heart meditated, she may have never seen it. But the enemy made it clearer to her. And he only pointed her in that direction. And it was her enemy that came over her, and she saw what she wanted. So 9 times out of 10, you get in trouble because of what you see.
Mm-hmm.
Then you allow people to speak into your ears mess that contaminates your heart. So now the gossip that replaces the gospel is going into your ear, and it's affecting your mind, how you think, how you respond. So now Sister Bodai comes in, and somebody has said something about Sister Bodai in your ear, and you didn't have the discernment to resist the temptation to allow that to come in. So now when you see Sister Bodai, you got an attitude with her because of what somebody else said. And Sister Bodai simply says, child, what I do to you? And you can't even explain what you did. What you're afraid to say is, I heard some gossip about you, about what you said about me last Sunday when I came up in here in my loosey-goosey dress, and you didn't like it, and you should have just came to me and said something about it, and we would be all good. And you already know, if she said something about it to you, you would have been mad with her. But because somebody else came and said something, now you're mad with her, and you thought nothing about the person that brought you that mess.
Amen.
The real culprit.
Yeah.
Because they brought you the mess.
Yeah.
If you took the mess, then they're the real culprit.
Yeah.
The enemy in you was now captivated by what they said, and what he says, now the law of my members have caused me to sin. Because me being mad with Sister Bodai is not of God.
Right.
Yeah. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
So he gets me in my ear, he gets me with my eyes, and oh my goodness, please don't let me start talking. Amen.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says, out of the heart, the mouth speaks. Whatever is the condition of your heart, the content of your heart, will come out in your conversation.
That's why
Paul says, let our conversations be better than they are.
Mm-hmm.
How we talk to one another, how we treat one another, how we speak to one another. That's a ministry all by itself. And a lot of times we walk in and we treat people bad with our mouths. We say stuff about people when they're not present.
Mm-hmm.
That's not of God. And Paul is saying to us and to the church at Galatia and Colossae that that is what tears people down.
Yeah.
The words that come out of your mouth, that again is a member of the body. Sometimes you do things with your hand. You walk to places with your feet. The Bible says resist the very appearance of evil. So you know what it looks like. And if you still start to draw toward it, that means that it has power over you.
That's right.
Paul says that's a struggle. But the struggle is not in that. The struggle is in you.
Yeah.
My pastor was very, very wise in keeping things simple. He says, listen, there's no power in the cheese. So when a mouse gets trapped in a trap, there's no power in the cheese.
Mm-hmm.
The power is his desire for the cheese.
Right.
And he's so overtaken by the cheese, but more important, his desire for the cheese, that he doesn't see the trap.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So now mice are smarter than they were last time I talked to them, but they're smarter. Now you got to put peanut butter on the cheese
mm-hmm.
to cover the smell or whatever. I don't know what it is. But you very seldom see mice now get caught in traps. And what's amazing, they can take the cheese now off the trap.
Mm-hmm.
And not get caught. Y'all ain't never had mice. Y'all don't understand that. Amen. But for those of us who have had to deal with it, mice don't get smarter.
Mm-hmm.
Their desire for things change.
Yeah.
And that's depending on where they're eating from.
That's right.
If a mouse is really hungry, the mouse is going to go for the cheese.
Mm-hmm.
And will die doing it. Just like many of us have died trying to get what we want.
That's right.
We may not have died physically, but we've died spiritually.
That's right.
We got caught in the trap.
Yeah.
And now the trap has taken life away from us. Mm-hmm. And now we're struggling to get out of the trap. And we can't find a way to get out of the trap. But if you've ever had glue traps along the wall, I've seen mice get caught in it, and I've seen mice get out of it.
Mm-hmm.
As long as the mouse keeps moving, as long as the mouth keeps pressing, the mouse has a way of wiggling themselves out of the trap. It's those that give up.
Mm-hmm.
And while they're in the trap and they give up, they lose the desire to live. They don't die because of the glue. They just die because they've lost their desire to live.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's how it works. Many people in the body of Christ have lost their desire to live. So they stay in the trap. And the trap is designed to destroy them.
Ooh, glory.
Mm. Listen to this last verse. Oh, wretched man that I am. Now, there's some theologians that said Paul was a young man when he said these things. And that where he was in the final stages of his ministry, there was no way in the world that Paul could have struggles. I beg to differ. I'm not going to argue with theologians. But if you think about where this is and who Paul is writing to, this is his final letter, amen, to the church. This is his last letter to the church. This is the place where he's come from. Paul is a Roman citizen, which means that Paul has spent his entire ministry waiting for the opportunity to minister to the Roman church. It's the church, the only church that we know of in the cluster of letters that he's written to the churches where he did not start this church. Mm. It is believed that those that were in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost were from Rome. They felt the power of the Holy Ghost. They were a part of the 3,000 that gave their souls that day. They went back to Rome, and with their own knowledge and their own interpretation of what needs to happen, they started a congregation. Mm. But without teaching and guidance, that congregation began to divide. Mm. Because the Pharisees and the Sadducees came in and said, "We heard that y'all want to be a part of the church. Here's what you got to do. You got to follow us, and then you can be in." In other words, this is our club, and if you want membership, you got to do what we say. Paul got wind of it, writes a letter to the church, and says that's not true. They are just as vulnerable as you are, and they have not set the standards God did. And God told me to tell you, that's what he said in the letter, that there's nothing that you can do to follow them that will get you any closer to him than what you're doing right now, and that's seeking God. So people, the church, the denominations, and everybody else creates these rules of how to get closer to God when all you have to do is what Paul is telling them is have faith and believe and obey.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Paul lays out. He don't lay out, walk 30 steps and then stop and look up. He don't say follow somebody for 21 days or sit on the mourner's bench. All of those are expressions that have been developed by people. But the word declares, if you want to be saved, you just have to confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe that God raised him from the dead, and you shall be saved. Period. If God chooses to empower me with the Holy Spirit, that's a part of my obedience. Speaking in tongues is evidence of the gifts of God, but if I'm saved and don't speak in tongues, I don't lose my place with God.
Amen.
You understand that? You understand
Amen.
That? Because everybody is not going to speak in tongues.
That's right.
But everybody has the privilege of being saved.
Yeah.
Because speaking in tongues is a gift. And Paul wrote in this same letter, when we get to chapter number 12, he'll tell us that everybody, there are many members, but not all having the same gifts.
Yeah.
There are people who have the gift of laying on hands. There are people who have the gift of interpreting dreams. There are people who have the gift of singing, of dancing, all of these other gifts. And all good and perfect gifts come from the Lord.
That's right.
So, but you'll see in the book of Acts that we're studying as a parallel here, that there was a church in Samaria. They got saved, but they didn't immediately receive the Holy Spirit. But they were saved. They were baptized, but didn't get the Holy Spirit until God sent Peter and John down to Samaria, and they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Not just, and they didn't speak in tongues. They just received the Holy Spirit. But God didn't give them the gift of tongues, because by that time, the gift of tongues had, what had happened was the people who had the gifts started exploiting the gifts and making people believe that if they didn't have it, they couldn't be like them.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing we're doing today.
Mm-hmm.
So the evidence is in the Word. And the problem that I'm having is people are not studying the Word. So now I'm running around here thinking I'm not saved because I don't act like you.
Amen.
And that's not the Word of God.
If
it were, then I should be a gazillionaire. Amen.
Amen.
How do you become a gazillionaire? People say just lay your hands on
them.
Is that it? Because I done touched a million cards and the alarm went off and I ain't got no keys. Name it and claim it. Call it and haul it. Blab it and grab it. All those things that they tell you. Go speak it and it's done. Tell the banker, you coming to get your car. You go and send that car if you want to. Police pull up. And what you say? I'm claiming it in Jesus' name. And you're in the jailhouse in Jesus' name. Some things you have to think through.
Yeah.
If God wants you to have it, the Bible says the blessings of the Lord are rich and add no sorrow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If God wants you to have it, God's not only going to give it to you, he's going to give you the means and the resources to take care of it.
Yeah.
If God gives it to you, you can't afford it, then you better ask yourself, is this of God?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There's no blessing that God has given that he had to repo.
Right.
Help me today, Jesus.
Amen.
Oh, wretched man that I am. My time is up. The word wretched here, people say wretched at my folk in Mississippi. Wretched. Oh, wretched man that I am. And the word wretched here in the Greek is, here it is. It's a long word. Telahi poros. Telahi poros. Enduring the trial. Miserable. Paul says, I was miserable because I was trying to live between two worlds.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of us are miserable because of the war that's going on. One day we do well, and then for some reason or another, we have a setback, and things don't work like they did on yesterday. Paul said, after going through that process, I became miserable. So my life, it seems to be uneasy. Because one day I'm happy, one day I'm sad. Then Paul says, fine, I got it. It's not the situation, it's me. Because I'm allowing my flesh and my spirit to war. I'm letting my flesh get the best of me.
Mm-hmm.
Because my confidence in God is wavering. So if I'm going to make it, I got to stop letting my confidence in God waver. It doesn't mean that the issue may go away. All it means is whatever God says is going to happen, I got to trust that.
That's right.
And I got to walk by that and believe that. And then ultimately, as the will of God is doing, being going forward, whatever God chooses to do with it, if he says this is the way it's going to be, I got to be satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
With that. Remember now, it's the same Paul in Corinthians that said, I sought the Lord three times for this thorn in my flesh. I asked the Lord, hey, I'm tired of this. Take this away from me. And I thought he was going to throw something down and wah, 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 and it's going to happen. And I'm going to walk out of there without this issue. And he shocked me. Paul says his response was, my grace is sufficient.
That's right.
I ain't taking it away, because what it does is it keeps you humble.
Yeah.
So every now and then, God's got to send a thorn in your flesh just to remind you that you ain't all that in a bag of chips.
That's
amen.
Right.
That we all go through that's something. Right. And when we do, it's not God punishing us, but it's God humbling us.
Yeah.
Because the humbleness of our hearts opens a way for the healing process to take place.
Yeah.
It opens a way for the hand of God to not only move on our behalf, but to start to direct us in the right way. That's what humility does. So it's important that we stay humble in God. It's important that we not look to ourselves, but as we read in Psalms 121, that we look to the hills from which cometh our help. So, oh wretched man that I am, I'm miserable. Watch this. He says, Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? He's now looking for a solution. He's now looking for a way out. He's looking for answers. So in this question, he's not directing this question at the church. He's directing this question to heaven. And I know this because verse number 25 says, I thank God through Jesus Christ. In other words, when I met Jesus, when I finally realized who Jesus was and how important Jesus is to my life and what I need to do, as long as I'm a part of the relationship with Jesus Christ, no matter what happens, no matter how bad it gets, no matter how dark it gets, no matter how gloomy it gets, everything is going to be all right. Why, Paul? Because he conquered death and the grave, and now he sits at the right hand of the Father, and he's working on my behalf. And because of that, no matter what I deal with in this world or in the flesh, I can always look to him. And when I look to him, Paul says in one translation, I realize it was Jesus that rescued me, not from the world. Jesus rescued me from me. And now he placed me in the world to be an example for the world, to be the light in the world, to make sure that my message and the method that he's provided for me are weapons and tools that I will use to help get other people on track and find the Lord for themselves.
Yes. Amen.
So that's what being dedicated means. That's why when he writes that letter to Timothy, in his final reply says, I fought a good fight. I kept the faith. I finished my course. We don't know what your course is, but God does.
Yes.
And you got to follow that course.
Yes.
Every day is not going to be rosy. Yes. There are going to be some good days. There are going to be some bad days.
Right.
Look at how he ends. He says, so then. Tell your neighbor, so then.
So then.
With the mind, I myself serve the law of God. Here's a separation and distinction. But with the flesh, the law of sin. God does not remove the flesh. He does not remove me from the flesh. But through this knowledge, he lets me know that I have to choose between the spirit and the flesh. And Paul uses the word serve here, and the word serve in the Hebrew and the Greek means dolio. Dolio means to be a slave to, voluntarily or involuntarily. So Paul is saying, I'm a slave to the principles of God. That means that I allow the principles of God to guide my footsteps and tell me where I go. And when I don't, I'm a slave to sin, where I allow my flesh to guide my footsteps and tell me where to go. So if I'm going to make it in this life, I got to lean more toward the Spirit of God and allow the Spirit of God to control, order, and to correct me when necessary. But if I'm going to do that, there are two things, my actions and my attitude.
Yeah.
My actions and my attitude. And when I understand how the enemy tries to use those two things to discredit my witness and to destroy my progress, then I'm going to be more inclined to lean more toward the things of God than the things of the flesh. So life, a living for God, is a state of mind.
Amen.
And when you understand that, you can walk out of this thing like Paul is walking out of chapter 7 into chapter number 8, relying on his rescuer, his Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. My question to you tonight is, where are you in your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? Are you satisfied? Are you confident? Do you really trust him as you say you do? Do you really believe in him? Are you standing on his promises? Are you convinced that he is the only way? If there are any doubts in your mind as to those questions, then there's some growing that needs to take place.
Mm-hmm.
How do I grow, Pastor? Study, pray, meditate, fast, and then my faith increases. Then I allow the Lord to test my faith. I allow me to go through trials and tribulations, which gives me patience and experience. When I have patience and experience, I begin to grow, and now I'm standing stronger than I was yesterday. I'm walking taller than I was last year. There's some evidence in my growth, and there is some evidence in my progress in the Lord. So the enemy cannot push me over and blow me over like he used to. He can't just throw a bone out and I automatically go to it. I've now got the ability to resist those things because of who Christ is in my life.
Amen.
And that, my friend, is what the church is all about.
Yes.
Church is truly a movement. It's not a mission. And we got some work to do. Bow your heads. Spirit of living God, I thank you tonight for this privilege and opportunity to be in this place. Thank you for allowing us to share tonight your word, the principles and precepts that you've given us to share with your children of how to live a better life, a life more pleasing to you, a life that not only you recognize and acknowledge, but a life that you ordain, a life that you govern, a life that you lead us through. I love you today, God, more than I did on yesterday because of the revelation. And I pray now for all of us that we stay in your will. Our prayer request tonight is to let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Keep us now, God. Cover us. Give us the words and the wisdom that we need to not only be effective witnesses to you, but to be true vessels, advocates for peace and love. Touch, heal, and deliver as you see fit according to your divine prayer. Amen and thank God. Come on,
amen. Amen.